What up, everybody? Appreciate all of you who checked out my conversation with Justin Smith. And this conversation was one I was very much looking forward to filming. A good friend of mine. Sometimes we're enemies, sometimes we're allies. We've been tag partners, we've been travel buddies, we've been party buddies. He's a very good friend of mine. He calls himself the cornerstone of reality of wrestling. None other than Ruthless Ryan Davidson. I can't wait for you guys to hear it. But before that, I wanted to cover a little bit as far as like future guests. I filmed my conversation with Kevin Bernhardt, aka Kelly Kevin, aka the director of Reality Wrestling, and that should be coming out next week. And then I also filmed a conversation with Robbie Gilmore, otherwise known as Rockstar Robbie or The Rockstar. Very eager to show those. And I have scheduled a conversation with Abel Andrew Jackson, Reality Wrestling's resident politician. I'm very much looking forward to that. Before I show the conversation with Ruthless Ryan Davidson, I failed to answer a question that was posed to me on YouTube by the username Nintendo Porn. What a great username. But I was asked, if it can be avoided, you would rather not be involved in the creative process while wrestling. And yeah, I wouldn't say I'd rather not be involved. I just don't want to be the head of creative and be a performer, because sometimes that can be a conflict of interest. It's hard to kind of walk that line. And I'd rather not. It's a stressful enough situation being either head of creative or being a performer, and I'd rather just do one or the other, if at all possible. But if I'm just part of creative, I don't mind still being able to perform, because at least there's other people that I can kind of bounce ideas off of and kind of work with to ensure that I don't fall victim to temptation. So if anyone else has any questions for future videos or such for me or for my guests, feel free to hit me up. Like I said, I'll have Abel Andrew Jackson next. As far as filming goes, the other two, Kevin Bernhardt and Robbie Gilmore, are already in the can. Just got to film the intros for those, but those will be released in weeks to come. Be on the lookout if you're in the Humble area. Reality Wrestling Summer of Champions, the iPay-per-view, Reality Wrestling's very first iPay-per-view. Go to realityofwrestling.com for more details. And without any further delay, I present to you my sit-down conversation with my good friend, Ruthless Ryan Davidson. Until the next time, later!
Alright, I got my phone on.
Do you have your phone on vibrate?
It's on vibrate. Steve, gosh dang, DeMarcatron.
Oh. So how the hell are you?
I'm great.
Oh, are you? Good. Oh, man, how was the fantasy camp?
Fantasy camp was good, man. It, a lot of people, man. A lot of people, it was like 45, 46 people, kids and everything showed up, like any age. Like they had like a couple of like 12-year-olds in there, and they're I mean, they were scrappy.
Yeah, oh, wow.
You know, it was cool, man. It was a cool experience. 5 hours went by real fast, man. And like there's even at one point, like at the beginning of the tryout, like Book had it like well, like planned to where it's like, all right, we're going to stretch, warm up, then we're going to go over this, and then we're going to circle, then we're going to go over tie-ups, headlocks, arm ringers, and then we're all going to do that, and then this and that. Like, and he had, like, I want the conditioning and stretching. I want Nico and Taylor to do that. He's like, for these type of drills, Ryan will handle it. These type of drills, Eric will handle it.
Oh, okay.
And I was just like, fuck, man, like, this guy, like, he thought about
it. Wow.
Like, yeah, it was, like, in-depth, right? So I was just like, okay, cool. And basically, it just went off like a hitch, man. It paid well. And, it was funny, sharp. Hey, Ryan, come here. And I'm like, walk over to her. I go, yeah, Queen, what's up? She goes, do you think we can handle this many people? I'm like, really? You're going to say this now? Like, we just got started? We got to be like, oh, man, like 20 of you guys got to fucking go home. We can't handle it. I'm like, oh, man, we got this. And got paid well. And I really appreciate that from Booker Sharpe. Because, I mean, I knew we were going to get paid. I just stated, I mean, what I was told I was going to get paid and what they actually paid me was completely beyond my expectations.
Wow, that's cool, man.
So it was cool. It was cool, definitely cool.
Do you know when he's going to do another one?
I have not heard of anything yet. The only thing that I've ever keep hearing, and just over and over and over, and I know it's going to be like this for the next 5 weeks, is the Summer of Champions.
Oh, okay.
It's all been
talk. It's all the talk.
WrestleMania.
Oh, my God. WrestleMania. And we'll get into that in a second.
The showcase of the immortal, baby.
How'd you get your start? In this wonderful business, like,
man, it's funny because it's like these, you know, just real quick before I go into that, it's funny when like kids come into like books and everything like that, and it's like at some points, and I know it's not their fault, but I'll just sit back and look sometimes and just look around and see these kids in the ring, and I'm like, you have no fucking idea how good you have it when you start off. Because that didn't happen to me.
Yeah.
I broke in literally in a wrestling ring on the side of the freeway in between Amarillo and Canyon at an outdoor go-kart track.
Oh, my God.
Yes.
Wow.
Amarillo Championship Wrestling. The guy, the dad and the son, and the son was a wrestler. His name was Bryce Payne. You know, nice people. They owned this, you know, his dad's like, oh, I'll get a ring, and I already got a promoter's license, so all right, whatever, which didn't matter because in Texas no one gives a shit. So, next thing you know, it's like, oh, well, where are we going to put this ring? We'll put it on our go-kart track. And legit, you drive up to the go-kart track, and like right behind the building that they have on the track, there was the ring.
Oh.
Oh, yeah. I mean, you could drive on the freeway, and you could see guys bumping in the rain off the side of the freeway.
Off the freeway.
Out the freeway. Yeah, outdoor training. And I don't know if anybody's ever been in the panhandle, but, man, let me tell you something. It's seasonal weather there. So when it fucking snows, it snows. Yeah. I have wrestled and have had matches in the gigantic, remember the old school like starter jackets.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Motherfuckers had starter jackets on, arm drags, body slams. Fuck out of here. Oh man, so funny. So yeah, an outdoor ring. They eventually got a storage unit, but it was bad. But yeah, that's where I broke into pro wrestling. Ooh.
And how long did you train until you had your first official match?
2 months.
2 months.
2 months.
2 months to just send you...
2 months. It would have been earlier, but the only thing was that, and I was only going to get potentially the early match, which would be about like a couple weeks before, but, you know, because this guy wasn't going to show, but then to come to find out, oh, hey, I'm here, you know, and he got his spot. They're like, okay, we'll get you on the next show. Then I got on the next show. And then after I broke in, it was about a month and a half, just around 2 months. And, like, I think my third match I had, they put the heavyweight title on me.
Wow.
Third match.
You were like, I have climbed the mountaintop.
My dick is huge.
Oh, my God. All the rats for me.
For me. Oh, dude, they don't exist anymore.
Oh, yeah. Man.
Whatever. Yeah.
So how long had you been wrestling before you came to PCW? I know I was... gone by that point, but
I was wrestling for probably like to say 2.5 years. I had a good solid year in Amarillo, and then right after my year, I moved to Oklahoma.
Okay,
I was with Tom Jones, who basically, to me, he's like the second guy. And it was weird, like how I was trained. Like I was trained by this one guy, which was okay, and then it went to Tom Jones, and then it went to Book.
It was
just crazy how it landed up, because it was like literally like beginner, novice, expert.
Yeah.
You know, it was like legit like that, like a stage. And another thing about my training is that, and this is going to sound crazy, I've never paid wrestling tuition.
Ever.
The only thing I've ever had to pay that was outside of books was like, I think like my first 4 or 5 months, $25 a month to come train twice a week.
Wow, okay.
$25 a week.
Huh.
And yeah, and it was a guy by the name of Blade, like this huge 350-pound guy who could do fucking like the forward flip bumps and all this shit. Like, most athletic, like him and Samoan Beans are like two guys that are like over 300 pounds that I've never seen like do like moonsaults
and
springboards and bullshit. But anyways, he was just all like, yeah, pay $25, I'll teach you how to bump, and just the basics and everything.
Nice.
And the private Terry Daniels from old World Class, he was actually at WWF for a while.
Oh, wow.
This and that and everything. Terry Daniels, if you ever go on ESPN Classic and, you know, they show the old World Class, you know, GWF and all that bullshit, or UWF, he's on there, and he's a fiery little fuck, man. It's funny.
Nice.
But yeah, it was that, and then Tom Jones in Oklahoma, the book, man. But yeah, Amarillo. Amarillo was a good experience, man. It was a good. Met Rex Reed there. Rex Reed was like the first guy. Like,
really?
I've known Rex Reed probably longer than, like, Rex Reed and Cody Jones,
okay.
Who wrestles a lot. Those are like the two guys that are like still actively in the business, been around, this and that.
Mm-hmm.
And I still keep in contact with those guys.
Oh, wow.
Much. Yeah. It's crazy, man. But yeah, that was a long time. So that's, fuck. Yeah, 10
been
years.
Been a while. So you went to PCW. What prompted you to go to PCW?
I did a show in Oklahoma. It was in Ardmore. And it was just the gigantic super card of a show. I'm talking me, my opponent, and one other guy were the only three indie dudes on the card.
Oh,
everybody else was Jeff Jarrett as TNA champion, AJ Styles, Christopher Daniels, R-Truth before he was R-Truth, Christy Hemme, Gail Kim,
nice.
Natty Neidhart, Molly Holly.
Wow.
Molly Holly, Scott Steiner, Lex Luger.
Oh my god, Lex Luger.
Okay. Fucking it gets who's in the other main event? There's like a tag match. It was Scott and Luger versus Jarrett and somebody else.
Mm-hmm.
And I can't remember. It was one other name. I'll think of them here in a second. But it was like this ridiculous card. It was like pretty much TNA and these three dudes over here. Like, that's pretty much at the time. It was just like, what the fuck, right?
Yeah.
So, I had this match with Aaron Neal, and he was, and I'll get to why I'm going, you know, getting into PCW and everything, but, it, you know, we're wrestling each other. He was champ of one Fed, I was champ of another Fed in Oklahoma. It was pretty much the only two Feds that mattered,
mm-hmm.
which was IZW, which was the better Fed, and then right behind it was Mid-South, and, like, he was the IZW champ, I was the Mid-South champ. I didn't make myself sound good right there. Anyways, fuck it, whatever. So they're like, oh, we're going to wrestle for who's the ultimate Oklahoma champion.
Nice, nice.
I'm like, oh, fuck me, right? Have this match. The referee was Jamie Oller.
Oh, wow, okay.
Yeah, or no, Jamie Oller reffed a match before this, but he was there at the show. He reffed a couple of my matches for, like, totally Texas wrestling, not Graham, Texas, like the middle of nowhere. And everything, and he was like, man, you should come to PCW, da 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 da. So I had the show in Oklahoma, had this match with Aaron Neal, it was great and everything. And it was like, we were in this gigantic indoor rodeo stadium that holds like 6,000-7,000 people,
mm-hmm.
and literally 600 people showed up.
Nice. Oof.
And it was just like, and they thought that they were going to sell this motherfucker out, and they had a card! But it didn't do it. Actually, it was more like 700 or 800 people, but either way, they lost their ass. They were projecting like 2,000-3,000, you know, type thing. But anyways, got done with the match, met with Oller. Oller's like, hey, let me introduce you to my two buddies. This is Robert Evans, and this is Aaron Eagle.
Oh, wow.
And I go, oh, hey, cool, nice to meet you guys. And they were both like, man, that was good shit, man. Like, that's really good. Man, you could, wow, okay. Hey, man, I mean, like, if you ever want to come down, we got this free show, uncut, but, you know, we can probably get you on the TV show, Full Throttle.
Okay.
And I was like, oh, man, that sounds cool. And me and Aaron really kicked it off, and, you know, Robert made me laugh and everything like that. He's a real very smart, witty guy.
Yeah.
And, he's like, yeah, come on down. And I go, okay. And then it was, somebody got booked there. I went with them just to do the show, and then, or I mean, not to do the show, but just to go with him, just to kind of introduce myself to everybody. First guy I met at PCW was BJ Turner.
Nice.
Nice guy. I like BJ. He was a good dude. And then everything else, I wasn't even booked, and then they're all like, hey, you wrestle too, right? Yeah. Oh, yeah. And it was Richard Hill. Fucking, oh, yeah, hey, you know, Aaron told me about you. Okay, well, you got your gear with you. I go, yeah. And he goes, does it look good? Like, it doesn't look like crappy, does it? He's like, no, it's good gear. You know, and he was all like, all right, great. Well, I'm going to put you in, like, this 7-minute match with so-and-so and just put him over. And I'm like, cool, man.
Yeah.
You know, and I was like, oh, man, this is, you know,
nice.
Back then, PC Dub, man.
It was
like, the place to be. Like, everybody was talking about, like, you know, we need to go to Dallas, man. All that shit. But anyways, yeah, that was pretty much my end. Like, Jamie Oller, majority part of it. Then it was a little bit pretty much of, like, Robert Evans and Aaron Eagle. So, good stuff.
But I don't think I really saw you wrestle until you were WOW. I think me and Adrian went to see the Crusaders.
Yeah.
And you wrestled Austin Rhodes.
That's right, bro.
Yeah, you wrestled Austin Rhodes. And
I'll be honest with you, man. A lot of people don't like Austin Rhodes. I've never had a problem with him. I've actually done some, been on the road with him a couple times.
Yeah.
Not a bad guy.
No, he seems very cool.
Really, man. Isn't. We've always worked well together. We didn't really, never really tagged well together. I don't know. Like, we've been in like two or three tags, and they just all gotten to shit for some reason. It was just weird. But anyways, I mean, he never wrote me the one. I'm like, fucking Austin Rhodes. Like, that's like, Austin Rhodes. That's it. Done.
But you, I remember taking it was like a 25-minute match. I don't think you were quiet for one second. You were talking to the whole.
Not quiet now.
No. Yeah, you. I was like, man, I'd be blown up just with all the talking this guy does. But yeah, man, we're blown away by your ability. I think at that point we told you should go to books.
Yeah, it was funny. I was in the back and Silky comes up. Silky Baines, who always, you know, has a fucking Bluetooth gimmick in his ear, and he's got the black and mild, like, say, fool, hold on, beep, you know, hit this Bluetooth. say, man, there's some motherfuckers out here that want to see you, dog. Just fucking black and mild. It's like Smokey, Silky, you can't smoke in the fucking locker room. He's like, I don't give a fuck, I got kids, shit. Can't do it. Anyways, so I go outside and it was fucking you and Adrian. I knew you better because we've known in PCW. And then when I first moved to Houston, I kept in contact with you and I was like, hey man, you know, thanks for, you know, we'll catch up. And you're like, hey man, I'm actually doing like pay per views, man. Like, come over, like bring like $5 and we'll chill.
Yeah.
So like, yeah, I'll come over and watch TNA. And that's when I first met Jessica James.
Yeah.
And I met Adrian. And it was like, oh, cool. And at first, I didn't know they were wrestlers. I knew Jessica was because I saw her like on posters and everything, PWA posters and shit. But I didn't know Adrian. I didn't know fucking Samson. I walk in, you fucking see Samson there. This big old jacked up Conan looking motherfucker. Looked like he like fucked like 12 dudes in prison or some shit. Just sitting there like, yo, what up, dog? And I'm just all like, oh, that man's going to try and rape me. Like, oh, fuck. And then Adrian, you know, his ass, he's just like, alright, man, yeah. And he even told me, he was like, man, when I first heard you did like PCW and you're on Full Throttle a little bit, then you did that uncut bullshit, you know, where all the fags go and wrestle. I was just all like, oh, fuck this guy, then whatever. Then he's like, man, I saw your match, man. And it was just like, that was it. We have to get this guy on, blah, blah, blah. And that's like the one thing he still consistently compliments me on, man. And like, it means so much and it's awesome. But yeah, it was just like, I walked outside, locker room, hey, Marco, it's like Adrian, like, fucking, like, shoved you. He's like, yo, man, you gotta come to books, bro. Bro, we can get you booked. Nah, fuck this shit. This show sucks. You need to come to our shit. Fucking, like, the and-one dude, you know what I mean? Just fucking getting guys hyped up on the mic. Oh, this guy was just and-one of compliments. I'm like, my fuck, man, thanks. You know, God, I'll go buy you a sandwich talking so good about me. You know, he fucking curses me out all the time now, but it's just like, it's almost like he's like so uncomfortable to say, he's like, you know, Ryan, you know, I fucking hate your face, but God dang, you made Austin Rhodes look like a million bucks. It's like, that's my one pass in life, you know? It's like, I can just sit there and murder a hooker, and it's like, it's okay, because damn it, you made Austin Rhodes look good.
Like, but Austin Rhodes is a great guy.
God, I love that fucking guy, man. Give him shit. I love that fucking asshole.
So, okay, you've been wrestling for a while. By the point you got to Booker's, and honestly, you know, we all complimented you on your work.
Yeah,
you get to Books.
Appreciated it.
What was the transition like for you?
It was completely different. It was definitely a. Like a change in the game, so to speak. Like,
yeah.
No disrespect to everything that I've done prior to going to PWA, but it was like all that prepared me to actually get the books, because it's like, you know, guys got, you know, PCW and like PWA, like outside, like got a lot of guys with good bodies. You can always tell how feds are with bodies and everything like that. But like PWA, it's like, fuck, man. Like, Booker fucking T, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, just like, you have to up your game because there's Booker T, like, watching you at all times. And even back then, Book was so involved with, like, hands-on training in the ring, locking up, bumping you around. He's sweating, killing himself, just like one of us. And it's just like, dude, I'm in the ring with Booker T, man. God, you had to up the game. It wasn't like anything else. Like I said, no disrespect to everything I did before, but it was like all that prepared me so I could be in a place like PWA. It was completely legitimately a step up from what I was mm-hmm. doing, for sure. No doubt. And the transition was... good.
Good?
It was good, because I was at Tugs and they taught me footwork and everything like that, so it better prepared me for books. But yeah, the transition was, you know... It was good, man. It was intimidating.
Yeah.
It was a little intimidating. I mean, all the cool guys or whatever and everything like that, but it definitely was intimidating. Books, like, you know, the one point of your match on YouTube pulls up like two matches on YouTube, and it's one where I wrestled Robert Evans at PCW. And it was great. It was a great match, but we did this comedy spot to where he yanks my pants and I'm tripping, falling all over the place with my long tights around my ankles. And then I take a bump to the outside, still with my pants down. I'm on the guardrail, and I have like this little manager guy that's with me who actually does like photography and shit for PCW.
Okay.
And I forgot his name, cool dude. But anyways, he goes to like run at Robert when he's sitting there like spanking me on the guardrail. He goes to run at Robert to grab him. Robert olays him, and then apparently looks like he's humping me in the ass.
Oh.
Like runs in the back, and Book's just sitting there like, what? Man, you doing that ha ha. I mean, you gotta be he he. You can't be ha ha. I'm like, like just because you used a different emotion between the word he and ha, like I should understand. Like,
oh, yeah. Okay, you should.
So I gotta be like slightly chuckled instead of belly laughing. I got it. Which was true. But yeah, he's like, nobody gonna take you seriously. I mean, I appreciate you entertaining, but that's a lot of ha ha. I did he he. See, when I was in the ring, everybody, you know, I'd sit there and, you know, I'm thinking to myself, I'm like, dude, you got your ass kicked in the supermarket. Like, come on, man. Dude, like, Lumberjack seems like he did some crazy shit. And there was like, ha ha, funny.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
This Book's a funny guy. He's like, I always did a little hee hee, but they knew when I got in the ring, that shit was serious. They took me seriously. Da 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 da. Which, you know, not knocking him, but I was just kind of like, fuck, man. Like, all right, man, cool. And I just felt like such a tool. Like, I don't want him watching this shit. You know? Like, I could have had any other match. Like, oh, let me just type it in. He goes, now, nah, YouTube, Ruthless Ryan. Bah. And I'm just sitting there.
Whatever the first match. One. Oh, man.
Dude, Book, scroll down. Fuck, no.
You're like, okay. There's this match on page two.
But no, man. Like, this, the school was such a big, big jump, man. Just the way things were ran. School at the time was huge. Had 6-7 rings.
Yeah. And the
it was like the performance center before the fucking performance center, you
That's
know?
True, man.
And it was just insane. I was actually just talking about that earlier today. It was a couple of guys, went to dinner because after that fantasy camp, went to go eat. Mm-hmm. And we were talking about that, like old school, like the, you know, the little indoor track that was around and everything. You had 6 rings. One had a fucking cage around it at all times.
Yep.
PCW kind of the same thing, but they had like 2 rings, right in the middle of the you know, the gym, which was awesome concept. That building, man.
Oh, the building was awesome.
That fucking building was unbelievable. The by far the greatest venue I've ever worked on the indies.
Yeah.
Like legit. And I mean, I'm talking like an actual legit, that's their home indie fed, not like, oh, hey, I got the armory for the weekend or something like that.
No, the training facility. Like,
that was the most consistent, nice place. Yeah, dude. Awesome.
So at PWA, what titles did you win at PWA?
Every one.
So the Iron Man, the tag.
For a solid year, I lost every match, and the same thing at PCW happened to me at PWA, where they started calling me Jobber. Jobber. They didn't give a shit. I was Ryan Davidson. They didn't care.
Yeah.
They're like, Jobber. Oh, it's the job guy. Oh, he has good matches. We'll know who to lose. It's all good. It's like, I don't know, like a more athletic Mikey Whipwreck. Just always kept my ass kicked, you know? Like, just a huge Mikey Whipwreck, pretty much. But anyways, for a year, and I had great matches with a lot of guys. My first match was a main event against Gustavo.
Oh, wow.
Title.
Wow.
I was like, Book, do I need to, like, you know, buy you dinner or something? Like, fuck, man, right on, you know? And went and did that, and it was great. Great match, everything like that. But anyways, like I said, for a solid year, I, you know, paid my dues and doing what was given, and I didn't look down on it. I was like, hey, man, I got to earn a spot here, you know, and everything like that. And I, you know, earned a spot, and next thing you know, bang, I was Iron Man champion. I was Iron Man champion for, like, a fucking year.
Oh, wow.
Dude, it was a long time. And then after that, got with Rubio. Rubio was my manager, which was awesome. And fucking next thing you know, Book's like, we should throw the tag titles on you guys. It was actually a Gustavo Mendoza idea, and he pitched it to Book. And I was like, oh, I always wanted to feud with Ruby. I never had that chance. You know, I'm doing this thing with Nico, da 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 da. Everything is like, I'm like, well, they give me some heat if I try and go against y'all with a fucking manager that's my tag partner. At first, I was like, but then, yeah, I thought about it. I was like, okay, yeah. And did it, fucking won the tag titles. Like, wow. Oh, God, Rubio was my tag partner. And that was legit the first time I ever won a tag title. I never won a tag title in the indies beforehand. Never won in Oklahoma. Oklahoma was always singles titles.
Hmm.
It was the mid-state champion, the Oklahoma heavyweight champion, the tri-state champion, and then I was even legit first ever new mid-south light heavyweight champion.
Oh my God. Oh my
God. Yeah. Wow. This guy eat a dick. Fucking yeah, dude. Like I was like 215 at the time, and I did the whole completely ripped off the Matt Hardy gimmick.
Nice.
To where he was not 215. They had a scale do the suit, and he's trying to make sure he stays weight and everything. I legit did that gimmick. It actually got over, but the main reason was because I always just like taking all the little guys' moves.
Yeah.
I didn't want to just throw them around. I'm like, yeah, give me the Rana and crossbody me and blah, blah, blah. But anyways, so that was my first. Anyways, going back to tag team champions, I'll ramble off if I keep going. Anyways, and then forget what the fuck we're talking about. So back to the tag team titles. Run with Rubio. Wow, it was the first time I ever won tag titles, and I mean with a real wrestler, you know, but he was great. We actually held those belts for like 2 months.
Nice.
You know, and then like a month or so after we lost them, Bull came up and he's like, man, you've been doing great. You've been having these awesome matches. You're entertaining. I love it. I think we're going to put the strap on you, man. Give Bulkster a little chase, da 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 da. Which was originally supposed to be like like me holding for like 3 or 4 months or something like that, and then do this big show where he beats me again. But it literally was like, I won the title. There was maybe 30 people there.
Oh, okay.
At the time, PWA, we just moved into the Clear Lake Sports Complex. We didn't do good.
Mm-hmm.
We weren't doing good at all. A couple of those crowds were rough, everything like that. But then it was, you know, whatever. And then won the title, and then literally the next month later, all right, you're going to have to give it back. And it's just like,
wow.
So I've never got to defend a heavyweight title of Books, ever. And actually, that was the last title I ever won. I haven't been internet champion or tag team champion, wow. ROW champion, none of that. Why? Somebody fucking tell
me
why.
We'll get into ROW.
Calm down.
That's right.
Yeah,
just relax.
Jeez.
Just relax.
Now, committee, Kevin.
Speaking of.
Kidding.
Kevin. IWE.
Oh.
When we started that, which I think you won. I'll be honest, man. I think that promo where I was like, oh, all you guys, just take the camera and go film somewhere. Just get yourself over. Get this. Like, it was the first show. And I remember everybody filmed them out of order, but you just kind of, man, you stole it. You stole it from, I mean, we had the Crusaders. We had like.
Dude, I know. How can you compete with those guys? Your fucking promos are gold.
But yours, man. I mean.
I rewatched it like a couple times because I know how you put it over, and I appreciate that, man. That's like compliments out the ass, dude. I love it. But I was just sitting there and I was watching it. I was like, you know, some of the wording was good, but I didn't really think it was that great of a promo. I was like, just kind of, But the, I mean, even the guys, because it was filmed up in that crow's nest, you know, and everything like that. And even when I was done, the guys were like, fucking hey, Ryan, you know. And I've done mic work before, PCW and everything like that. But it was funny because when that video got put up, he even had a couple of the boys from Dallas were like, damn, dude, I didn't know you can cut good promos. I'm like, are you fucking serious? Like, I've been on the mic all the time, fucking asshole. But no, it's cool, man. But yeah, that promo, man, I just I felt it because IWE felt like it was something like pure.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Because that's what it was. It was a wrestling organization ran strictly by wrestlers.
Yeah.
Some people be like, that sounds like a shitty comment. No, it wasn't, because we all had the same passion, the same idea, and we were literally like, this needs to be just as good as like Books.
Yeah.
Just a lower schedule. Like if you know, Books was WWE, we were the fucking ECW.
We
wanted to be the person. Right behind him.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody believed in the cause, man, and it was fun. God, it was fun.
Yeah.
Lots of fun.
All the after parties. The after parties were always a blast.
Fucking Jason.
Probably the thing. Miss most from the wrestling days of the.
And coming to the dojo, crew members get fucked up. Yeah, Quincy Q, fucking won't name any names, hugging fucking toilets and shit. All fucked up. Everybody's fucked up. Teabag Ricky Douglas or something. I don't know. Somebody did something. Shit. Q would get plastered because he doesn't even really get that plastered anymore. But it's like, I look back on him like, that motherfucker got like white girl wasted. Like, he was fucking dude. You know? Like, I'm like, what do you do? Man, but we were all like that. It wasn't just him.
There was a couple times
I got fucked up.
Yeah, definitely
sure.
A party.
I was like, you wake up and like, the way Jay's house was, it was a nice house. I liked it a lot. But some parts of that house, it literally looked like you're walking into a fucking horror show or like a haunted house. Like somebody was gonna come through the window.
Yeah.
Like one hallway was always lowly lit and they had like green, reds and like these fucking demon looking like fucking posters and Rob Zombie. I'm like, fuck, I'm in a haunted house. Oh no, it's a real home. There it is. There's the living room. Scared the shit out of me sometimes. Like, god dang, fuck, staying the night and waking up in the middle of the night trying to take a piss in this place. No way, I'll fucking get scared. Like, oh god.
Man.
It was funny. Good times. But yeah, the after parties were dope.
You and I have teamed. We've been.
Sweet meat.
Sweet meat. I'm still waiting on the t-shirt design.
Give Paw Patrol a run for their money.
Oh my god,
yeah,
that was so much
sweet
fun. We were putting out videos. TASW was putting out videos all the time.
Oh yeah,
good stuff. Feuded for a bit.
We did.
Then you went to. When did you go to Jared's PWA?
Oh man, I would like to say 2011.
Mm-hmm.
2011, like shortly after. IWE and then, you know, went to books and everything like that, and then kind of was on All-Star, and then Jared was like, hey man, I got a show, this and that, and I've always heard of Jared Steele's show, like ever since I've been back in Houston.
Yeah.
Like even before it was books, like I heard about Jared Steele, and everybody'd say, well, it's the Jared Steele show, and I go, well, what do you mean? And I've never met him at this time, and they're like, well, he's the promoter, but he's like the guy, like all the shows about him. Like
The logo
on the ring is of him, and this and that, and whatever. So, of course, your first initial thought is like, this guy's like all fucking full of himself. And then you meet Jared, and he's just the coolest guy.
Yeah, yeah.
He's not that at all. Yeah. Family man, he's got a great family and all that. And he was he was the man at PCW forever.
Oh, yeah, no,
you know?
He was.
Like, he was the guy. Yeah. You know, and I've seen him wrestle on FIP DVDs. Mm-hmm. Like, he had this triple threat. I'm in great shape. He had a triple threat between AJ Styles and fucking MVP.
Oh, nice.
At an FIP show, and I was just like, man, like, this fucking Jared Steele.
Yeah, he had a triple threat with Styles and Craven.
Dudes through barricades and ladders and shit. Like, oh, man, that guy was the man. So, cool shit. But, yeah, I started wrestling for him probably, like, I think it was 2011. I know it's been a couple of years.
Mm-hmm.
It's definitely one of the shows that I miss doing because it was just so much fun with just kids, man.
Yeah.
Like, just kids, and then like, you know, me and Adrian tag stuff.
How was that, man? I mean I never got to really see. I saw like little
best times.
Moments, man.
Best times. I actually got it away with it at a wrestling show for Halloween, and I got this idea because I had this one Halloween show years prior. I was at NWA Oklahoma and I wrestled Mr. Saturday Night Michael Berry.
Mm-hmm.
Great guy, great wrestler.
Okay.
Awesome dude. And we had this match, and the promoter's like, hey, we want you to do this trick-or-treat match. So I was like, what the fuck is that? And there's like, well, you'll have a box in each corner, and one box will have, you know, like a gimmick inside. Like, one box will be like a legit, like, gimmick. You can hit somebody.
Yeah.
Next box might be candy.
Mm-hmm.
You know, next box might be something else, and another box would be like Halloween, you know, memorabilia or whatever.
Okay.
You know, something. And I was just like, and he's like, but you don't know what's in each box. So you could go, and first thing could be would be the gimmick, or the first thing would be like fucking candy, you know.
Oh, then how you got the match?
I mean, we knew what was in the box, what each box, but it was like, okay, I'll go to box one, you go to box two, and box three, and then I'll take box four and duck the gimmick or whatever. Anyways, match turned out to be great. So this actually happened at Jared's, and I got the way with this, and that's why I had to give this backstory was because I had the same idea. I go, we're gonna do the fucking trick or treat match at Jared Steele's, because I'm working Jared Steele in the main event. For the Halloween match or whatever. So I go, Jared, get four boxes. Let's put one with some candy on it. Let's put another one with the gimmick, one with, like, confetti in it, and then, like, one with, like, toilet paper. like a shitload of toilet paper, rolls of it, rolls and rolls.
Yeah, yeah.
Just pay attention, I'm getting to this. So I know I tell awesome, graphic, long as shit, detailed stories. So, anyways, he's like, well, you know, what's toilet paper for? And I fucking watched Platoon like two days prior.
I want to say we were there for that. Yeah.
The fucking part to where home dude, I forgot his William Dafoe.
Thank you.
William Dafoe taking the shot, getting hit, right? Yeah. Like fucking dying while he's looking at Charlie Sheen. And I'm just like, you know, like the most epic movie scene ever, right? I go, I want to do this while being thrown toilet paper.
Nice.
So I go, Jared, here's what you're going to do. You're going to hit me, bang. You're going to go around, like, hit me with your steel plate. Don't even go for the pin. Roll out, grab toilet paper. You just start passing it to the crowd. Pass it all around. These little kids, mind you, there's a shitload of kids at Jared's. So yeah. They're like, yeah, give me this, man. Dude, everybody had toilet paper. Came up, and I go, Jared, you're going to let them go. 1, 2, 3. Throw it, and I want people to throw all the toilet paper in the ring, rolls of it, and I want to sell it like William Dafoe in Platoon, and go all the way down, and it fucking happened, and it was great.
Yeah.
I had my own movie moment, legit, in a pro wrestling ring. Somebody please tell me they had that same experience.
Oh, man.
Somebody please tell me. It's great. Just pick a scene from a movie, and you could fucking totally get away with it.
So now, Booker's PWA rebrands to Reality Wrestling.
Reality Wrestling.
Now, were you around? I know you were around, but what was the transition like for you guys?
Once again, like a game changer. It felt like, you know, we were just starting. We had our ups and downs with PWA when we were back at the Clear Lake Sports Complex. And it was like something like, we need to change. Like completely, like how you look at it from like, you know, pretty much like Monday Night Raw to like Raw's War type thing, mm-hmm. whatever, you know, like how it started and then like how it is now. It's just like a complete different dynamic. We had to do that. And basically, once again, taking another step up. And it was actually like well more thought out, because you know how many times guys complain, we don't do feuds, they're just matches. And
yeah, it was always just wrestle around,
okay. I wrestled Gabe Hoggler for like 3 fucking straight months. The very next month after we wrestled for 3 straight months, we were in a tag together against Jay Lethal and Consequences Creed. It's like, oh no, we hate each other, man. He's like, I don't know, fuck it, I want to drink afterwards. Gabe being Gabe, the rascal, love it. So it was a good time, but yeah, it was like I said, it was a step up, man, and it felt like everything was changing. Everything was so well thought out, and planned, and you know, just, the way it should have been.
Yeah.
You know? And we just felt like it. The transition from when it went to the syndication that we had, even though it was just YouTube at the fucking time.
Yeah.
You know, it was just all like, man, people just paid attention. It was all because, like, this is Booker T's wrestling.
Yeah.
And a lot of people didn't even know. And I know there's still a lot of people that don't know in the city that there's actually a legit wrestling organization in Houston.
Yeah.
It's like, why would people not want to come to this? Like, it's crazy. So, anyways, that was the same thing. We're just trying to get a name, this and that, but it was just like the way the ring looked,
mm-hmm.
you know, the way the staging was like the main thing too, besides mm-hmm. Booker T's name, was the staging.
Yeah.
We've seen a stage like that besides like RO, and we had a better stage than a lot of ROH shows.
Yeah, yeah.
Because they just had the ramp and the one square trusses and a ROH banner.
Oh yeah, this,
there you go.
RW's,
yeah, the fucking guardrail gimmicks, like the round the ROH ring, probably, that's like where all their production money went. It went through the lights or anything. It's just so they could bang on the shit. But anyways, yeah, the fucking stage now, it's like, it's going to be only a matter of time until we get the opportunity of like fucking pyro.
Oh, man.
Or the, you know, the elevated lift from the beneath that comes up. You know what I mean? With smoke and shit.
Yeah.
Because Dojo, man, they just know their shit. And just, it's such an epic stage, man. It's so cool. You know, strobes.
Part of the fun of the Reality of Wrestling TV tapings is the setting up. And I mean, you're kind of the lead in a lot of ways. Like, you're the, no, Ryan, let's be honest, you got 7 stitches the last show, and there were people going, what are we going to do? Ryan's not here to call the shots.
Come on, fuck.
It's like a 13, 14-hour day. But I mean, everybody puts in the work.
Everybody puts in the work.
I mean, it's definitely an
improvement. It's gotten way better than it has been. But, I mean, I hate setting up the ring. Who like.
So yeah, yeah. No, that's
easy now. Least. I've done it so many times, but.
Well, the good thing is there's a lot of people now. I think like.
Fuck yeah.
I think at one point there was like four or five, maybe.
No joke. So. No joke. Yeah, but I mean, the production is incredible, man.
Yeah, yeah.
Just the way the videos are made, the custom music.
Yeah.
Just, you know, all this other stuff, man. It's just, it's
the awesome. Video packages.
Everything's, oh God, the video packages, man. The Team International video packages. I'm like, God, you fuckers, like, you know, just awesome. They're great. And then, like, the lighting, like that one promo I saw where, like, Oz, like, bent down, like, in despair because, like, him and Rex were, you know, not, excuse me, Volkov, Sergey, whatever the fuck your name
is. It's all right.
Kozlov.
Right. Yeah, what are we going to call
it? Anyways, God, I love Rex. It was just like, he did this lighting where he bent down. He was just like, you know, like, just in despair, and that lighting just hit his face. And I'm like, it's fucking good. Like, I need some lighting in my promos. Like, I think that's when you make it in the promo world at ROW. You get
special lighting.
Just special lighting.
Because Cedric has special lighting.
Just put like a red or green light, like, looking in my eyes. And just be like, yeah, the Stevie behind me. Yeah, yeah. Export tutelage. Yeah. You a bitch. B-I-T-C-H. Period.
What's having Stevie Ray as your manager?
Awesome, man. Awesome. I fucking love that guy. He's funny as shit. Smart. Mm-hmm. Really, really has some great ideas. You know, and just helpful, man. And it's cool. At first, I was like, man, I don't see it, but it's Stevie Ray's, and I'm going to be associated with Stevie Ray.
Yeah.
Because, once again, Stevie Ray is fucking, like, 20-time tag team champion.
Yeah.
You know, this man grew up, you know, watching him and Book, you know. So I was just like, fuck, this guy's going to be, like, my manager. I don't even care if he just fucking picks his teeth on the side of the ring. He's still in the record books, my manager. And he's done so much, his promos and everything like that. And we click, man, because we tell each other, like, he's at the top of the roster. He's like, man, I like that shit. You should keep doing that. So we cut a promo before I worked Hurricane. He's like, you know, Ryan's the, and he looks at me and he goes, the top, and we're doing it at the same time. So I'm like, oh man, we got our thing.
Nice.
We got our thing. And he's easy to talk to. He tells me some great WCW stories. Stories.
Nice.
I got stories for days between him and Book, just about the shit they told me. Great, man. I think it's awesome. Good heat getter. He gets me just much, if not, there's been a lot of times that he's gotten more heat, you know, and everything like that, which is fine, because I'm like, fuck, they're reacting, baby. That's all I care about, you know. But great, man. I can't say enough good things. I'm like, man, we should ride this out, this whole Stevie Ryan thing.
He
communicate with me, you know, Beast, he just grunts like, you know. So, but still does good with him, too.
So, you and Q, like, I mean, honestly, man, I've known you a long time. You guys have always seemingly had great matches.
Yeah.
I mean, IWE, you had great stuff. I know you kind of always referred to him as your steamboat to your Flair.
I did.
Yeah.
What kind of arrogant shit?
Nah, man, but it was like, but that was the mood.
He's my steamboat, you know, and I'm fucking Flair, man. You guys, you know, eat a dick. Yeah. That's not even true at all. Like, I was like, why the fuck did I just say that? God. Just be like, God dang it. I don't know. We work well together. Fuck. How easy, how hard would that have been? No.
Steamboat Flair.
Oh my God. Yeah, you just,
oh my God. But y'all had this, I mean, honestly, you know, we kind of knew your matches became kind of the thing to look forward to. You know, when we knew you guys were on the card,
it was
cool. Kind of one of those things where everybody was watching the monitor. Everybody was real intent on seeing what you guys would pull off, because again, your chemistry in the ring's just phenomenal. And I know, you know, you came out on the winning end, but yeah. I mean, honestly, what I don't think that guy really realizes how good he is. I don't think he
doesn't, man. Like, he doesn't. The one thing that Mysterious Q needs is just, he needs to, like, wouldn't say step up in a match wise, but step up by having more confidence in your work, more confidence in how things are. He's gotten better at it, but there's still that, you know, like, oh man, da 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 da, you know, I don't know, this and that. because, you know, I mean, him and I, peanut butter and jelly, man, we just went well together. Just, you know, we were awesome, but there were a lot of times, you know, he'd get, you know, it's understandable, and I guess just me being more experienced, I was just, you know, big crowds don't get me as much. Like, obviously, they get you hyped up, but I'm not nervous at all. Like, I'm nervous about the match. I'm not nervous in front of wrestling all these people. But he'll be getting nervous. He'll be like, oh, man, all those people out there, man. Yeah. I don't feel well, man. Then I'm like, nah, baby, it's game time. Like, yeah. We're good. Yeah. And then he'll be like, all right, yeah, you're right. And then we'll go out and we'll do it. You know?
Yeah.
But, I mean, as far as his talent, fuck, man, that's a limit I can't even describe. Like, the guy just can do anything. And like, oh, yeah, you're 6'3", legit 220 pounds. Oh, okay, and you could, oh, I'm sorry, 450s and springboards and shit? Oh, fucking fantastic. That's great. Awesome, you know? Like, just, I mean, he does some cool shit, and he was always the guy, especially when we were first working, it was like, hey, Q, like him and Pride are like the two guys, are like, hey, you know, I saw this on a video game. Do you think you guys can do this? Oh, yeah, like this? And they just do it. And it's just like, fuck, man, I was kidding, you know? Like, man, I don't know. Like, see, like, man, let me see if he can do this shit. He'd be like, yeah, actually, I could. Like, Q would be like, he wouldn't know at first, but they'd be like, yeah, I mean, we could try it. And it was like, all right, we try. And it just worked. And I'm like, you athletic motherfucker. Yeah, like, man. Golly. No, really good. I just, you know, talking, performance is not a problem, but yeah, his athleticism was really, really up there. Upper echelon, for sure. That top shelf, athleticism. Top shelf.
Pay-per-view, July 26th.
WrestleMania.
No, Summer of Champions.
Summer of Mania. Summer Mania.
Oh my God, it's going
That's it. We just named it Summer Mania.
We just sold tickets.
Summer of Champions.
Oh man.
Oh. Passé. Whatever. Passé. Yeah, oh, it's going to be dope. I'm excited, man. Excited.
You know who you're facing?
The Pride.
The Pride.
You know, ROW, love them to death, but one of their worst things ever, card subject to change. Holy shit. You'll get told one thing for 4 fucking weeks, work with a guy or talk about shit, whatever, and on the day of, scratch that, you're working home, dude, you've never met before. What the fuck? Or some guys don't even get, they'll get taken off the show. They'll be on the flyer and everything. They'll be advertised, and it's like, I've been bumped off. It's like, what? I was like, holy shit. Anyways.
Oh, my God.
Like I said, love RWW. That's my place, man. But, yeah, I mean, it's just like, killed me. Card subject to change. Anyways, yeah, but, I wish somebody would just stick to some storyline. That's all it was.
But
the IPPV is going to be dope, and I should be wrestling Pride.
Should be wrestling.
And, you know, it was good, and once again, Pride, the guy.
Yeah.
When I got the first got the PWA, he was the guy that, like, oh, we got a name on the card? All right, he'll work Pride. You know, like, that was, Pride worked everybody. Mm-hmm. So experienced, so athletic.
Yeah.
So athletic. Just still, like, to this day, one of those guys, like, hey, Pride, like, hey, man, you know, and he'll even tell me, he's like, hey, Honcho, hey, man, like, when you go to cut me off, instead of just doing something easy, how about you just pull me back? I'll just fall all the way to the floor. It's like, what? No, save your body. We don't need to do that. No, he's like, hey, man, I'll do it. I don't care. And like, he's so fucking down to do whatever you want.
Man.
And I'm just sitting there like, no, man, I'll just do this. It's okay. All right, man, I'm just saying, I can fucking flip off and die and come back to life, get set on fire, and then get eat my piranhas, then come back, and then fucking be like, all right, what's the next spot? Yeah. I'm like, oh, God. Mm. Just down to do whatever the fuck, man. He's great. I love the Pride. Pride is funny.
Now, I guess once we got the national TV deal, we all got the announcement. I mean, for me, not so, didn't affect me. I was kind of like, oh, cool, ladies and gentlemen.
Right.
I can take a break.
Yeah.
And I will gladly tutelage all of you.
Yes.
But, you know, you get that announcement. What was going through your head? I mean, honestly, man, you were working all over the place at that point. I'm pretty high up on the card, holding titles in certain places. But you get that. And honestly, we knew it was for a good reason. I mean, as far as, hey, this is a national deal.
Yeah, it's tough. And I, like I say, I was just, we were just talking about it. I was with Eric Lockhart and Kevin and Taylor and Ivory and then Wayne from the school and everything like that. And we were just talking, like, one thing. It's like, man, I know we got national TV. And it's great. Don't get me wrong.
Yeah, I'm completely like,
oh, my God, are you kidding me? The only time I ever thought I'd ever be on national TV every week is obviously working for the E. And never thought it'd be on, like, on our level and shit. And I was just like, man, this is amazing. But it just, you know, since we can't work anywhere, it's just get on these conversations. They're like, I miss the road.
Yeah.
I miss the road trips. I miss the crazy shit that can happen. Like, hey, we might get a place in here and then stay with this guy or whatever. But I don't know. We'll make it work.
Yeah.
And you make it work. It was a fucking adventure. And each, you know, each road trip, you can have an inside joke for years.
Yeah.
Just based off that one. It's an inside joke for every trip.
Yeah.
You can have conversations. Like, remember when the fucking Eddie, like, did this with the fucking, with the Tomb Tomb pin? Oh, man, what a moron. You know, like, and you just, like, it's because of that one wrestling show you did on the road. And that was one thing that, you know, I miss. And, I, you know, like I said, national TV is great and everything, but I miss doing the other, you know, we're just working a couple other places, but then again, it's understandable. I get it. It's smart.
Yeah.
It really is smart, you know, and everything like that. But, you know, to me, it's kind of good to rest on the body, but, you know, it doesn't hurt to, like, all right, man, I'll go catch the Sunday show. Or,
yeah,
man, I'll go do a show for you in Beaumont, no problem, you know.
Yeah.
Great locker rooms and everything like that, man. So, miss it. But yeah, man, the national TV, fuck. Who the fuck? I mean, who really can say they're on national TV?
That's true.
You know?
That's true.
I mean, obviously, besides companies we all know,
yeah.
Anybody else, it's like, might be syndication, might be DVD syndication.
Yeah.
You know, okay, cool, whatever. But we're consistently every week, Wednesday night, 8 o'clock on this network, bang, we got your attention for an hour.
Yeah.
Hopefully an hour.
Yeah, hopefully.
Which, yeah, we obviously we do. But you know, unless, you know, fucking Kid Ransom's booked. I don't know. I'm just kidding. Had to get one Kid Ransom joke in there. Get
Oh, man.
I love Kid. Good guy. Good fucking dude.
Now, you mentioned the E, and you've gone to a few. You've been on the list a few times.
Quite a few times.
What's that experience like?
Awesome. Awesome, and like it's pressuring too, man, because you hear so many horror stories about, you know the big thing in wrestling that's almost like a respect thing throughout this business is locker room etiquette.
Yeah.
Like backstage etiquette and everything like that. So you always hear these horror stories of like, man, don't talk to so-and-so, and don't go into catering, and don't do this and
don't,
that.
Don't roll your bag in.
Your hand. Yeah. Oh, sir, it's nice to meet you. Don't do that. Don't do that. Just like, hey, what's up, pal? Like, he's your buddy. You know, even give him an ass slap or something. Nah, I'm just kidding. Anyways, like, don't do this. Don't look him in the eye. Blah, 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 blah. And then you're just sitting there, like, literally, like, trying to go up there. We got, like, oh, Mr. Shawn Michaels, it's nice to, well, Triple H, good sir. Clear yourself, I'm sorry, don't mean to make you mad, you know? Like, fucking just, like, oh, it's a trip. Because you're, like, you walk to a building, and literally these guys just, like, walk past you, like, hey, what's up, man? You're like, oh, okay, what's going on? Randy Orton, holy shit, you are huge. Oh, man. Like, I'm like, there's fucking Randy Orton right there. Hey, what's up, buddy? What's going on? You know? And, or even, like, legends, man. First time, back to Ric Flair, met Rick for the first time. I was like, Ric Flair?
Yeah.
That's Ric Flair. He was just like, he called me, sir. He's like, how you doing, sir? Very nice to meet you.
Nice.
Good stuff. And I was all like, fucking woo, you know, like, woo, you know, like, do it back, real mom, everything like that. But yeah, it's just, you know, the environment that you're in. I mean, there's no other environment on the planet, like, obviously being in the WWE or, you know, something like that. I mean, it's the truth, and just like the pressure too, because you're always constantly being watched. Locker room etiquette is huge, polite. As long as you don't weird anybody out, you're okay. If you just act normal, like, say hi to somebody, like, how you went on the street, like, oh, hey, man, what's up, da 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 da. If you try to do that, very nice to meet you, sir. It's like, they're going to be like, fucking tool bagging out of here. They don't care, you know? And they're not going to sit there and judge by your handshake. We should give you a contract. You know, it's like, fuck out of here. Just say, hey, man, very nice to meet you. Right on. cool, that's it. Anyways, and then, you know, you get in the ring, that's a whole nother gimmick too, because, I mean, you get to see the stage, you get to see the viewpoint
from
how it is every night.
Yeah.
And just awesome. And then even if you're wrestling, like if you actually get to do something, even if you like do a run in and you get bumped around or somebody kicks your ass, you know, like couldn't tell you the high I felt when I was sitting there beating up Sheamus. Oh my God. And I got like three shots in there, great camera shots, a fucking gimmick and again again. And he fucking caught me, he's like, alright, fella. And I was like, oh God, you are so stiff. Wow. Get him out of the corner. But like even beforehand too, like I was in the ring with I've been in a ring with some guys through, you know, being doing, you know, the WWE extra thing and tryouts and everything. Like I got to wrestle with some guys, I was just like, holy shit, you know. They have a match with Alex Riley, who oddly enough is going to be at the iPay-per-view.
Oh, okay, yeah.
I wrestled Alex Riley, had a good match with him, and then I was like rolling around with Jamie Noble.
Oh, wow.
Doing spots, rolling around with Jamie Noble, rolling around with, you know, William Regal and everything, like, which was great. I even had an opportunity after I wrestled Alex Riley. Dean Malenko showed me some stuff, and I'm like, this is fucking Dean Malenko.
Oh, wow.
But the best experience ever about any guy that I've gotten the wrestling business with, or got in the ring with from WWE, was Arn Anderson.
Oh, wow.
Legit for like an hour and a half with Arn Anderson.
Wow.
Because I'm getting beat up by dudes, and then he'll be like, no, put him like this. And he's like, lock up with me. Bang. Get here, and then we'll just start going. And I'm just like, I'm fucking the enforcer. Oh my God. Oh my God. I'm trying to. This is like I'm total fanboy all over this dude, right? So, and it was great. And Robbie was there too, and Robbie got used a lot and everything like that. And crazy, man. Like you're in a ring, and then you get to like walk around and see these guys in real life, and it just. It's a trip, man. It's not even just meeting like all the stars and everything, but it's just the way things were ran and like this is it. This is the major leagues. Like it's literally in comparison, like you basically like, you know, I'm in the minor leagues for baseball and I'm on this AAA team and all of a sudden for one day the New York Yankees needs me to play fucking shortstop for a day, you know, or the pitch hitter or something. And it's like, that's unheard of in baseball.
Yeah.
You know, or in football. I play for the Canadian League, but for one game, I'm going to get a call from the Texans and I'm going to play, you know, backup center or something. It's like, that doesn't happen.
Yeah.
Not for just for one game.
Yeah.
You know, so like going to WWE is like from anywhere else, it's just like, fuck, man, this is it.
Yeah.
This is the place. This is how things are ran. Meeting everybody and watching it and learning, man. It's like going to school. And these guys pay you. I don't pay them. Like, again, the type of education and in-ring experience from guys like Arn Anderson, William Regal, Dean Malenko, Jamie Noble, guys like that, I would have paid thousands and thousands of dollars for that hands-on experience, and I got it for free. And not only did I get it for free, they paid me $200 to $250 each show that I was on.
Wow.
And I'm like, wow, you know, just unbelievable. But, you know, at the same time, the other thing is, too, is that if you're not ready, you know, they won't look at you a certain way if you're not ready or feel like that you're in a competitive edge to get a job. You know, this and that, so that's why you got to be in shape, you got to look the part, this and that, and everything like that. And I was in shape, and I had good matches there and everything like that, but I didn't look the part, obviously, which what everybody constantly looks, you know, works on and everything like that. Well, you know, that was the whole thing, is that I always thought, it was like, if I go too much and I don't change each time I go, then they're not going to look at me serious. They're not going to look at anybody serious.
Yeah.
And that's why I haven't been back since, like, 2012, 2013 or something. Been there, been about a year, you know, year and a half, because Sheamus, that was the last thing.
Yeah, yeah.
And, you know, that's basically it, man. I mean, WWE, it was great. I'm definitely thinking about going back to this one this month.
Okay.
At the end of this month.
Yeah, after,
just
right
doing,
after
just
the
doing it just to be relevant.
Yeah, yeah.
Just be relevant, you know, and it probably won't even use, but it's just like, okay, just roll around, you know. Regal knows me by name, which was awesome. Like, who would ever thought a guy of his importance, his level, but, oh, Ryan Davidson, nice to meet you, see you again, blah, blah. I'm like, fuck, nice. You know me? They're like, I think Michael Hayes thought I was somebody else, but he was all like, hey, Ryan, how you doing? It's good to see you. I'm like, yeah, we've never had a conversation one-on-one, and you know my name. Right on, cool, man. And, you know, that definitely got to go to book, too.
Yeah.
Because that's another thing, man. If you book co-signs anybody, you're gold.
Yeah.
Literally. They'll sit there and go, dude, this guy, whatever. Wait, he's at books. Books, he's at your school? Tell me how he is. And the book's like, I'm in. Yeah, all right. I'll put that on it. It's all good. They'd be like, oh, really? And that demeanor completely changed just because book co-signed on him. That's how much his word means. You know, it's crazy. But yeah, WWE, as far as working there, the experience there, awesome. Got to meet anybody and everybody, get in the ring, get bumped around by a few of the talent and guys there, and everything like that, and just, I mean, get in with some legends.
Yeah, yeah.
Meet some legends. Get in the ring. Fuck, man. Like, Malenko, Anderson, holy crap.
Yeah.
Man. Unbelievable.
Like, for anybody who wants to be a part of reality wrestling, like guys that have been on, or guys or gals who've been part of the indies, and if they wanted to come in to reality wrestling and possibly earn a spot, what possible advice would you give anyone? Because it's different, you know, like...
I would basically, it's kind of, like, I mean, obviously, the obvious advice I would give them would be like, hey man, it's, I wouldn't say it's day one of your wrestling career, but you need to treat this place like, you know, like, yes sir, no sir, like this is your year one, year two, and be humble and this and that, whatever. But I think the problem is with a lot of guys and girls in the indies, and it's understandable, they're awesome at all these other places, and then they just try it, and they're just thinking that books is just another indie fed, I'll get on the indie fed, so they don't have to act a different way, and I think that hurts them. So my advice would be just be humble and yes sir, no sir, and treat it like, you know, this is year one, year two, and you're just so respectful, and you're just trying to learn and everything like that. Because if you go in there with a sour attitude, like, oh, fucking blah, 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 whatever, no one's going to be like, we're not booking that guy again. I mean, he had an okay match, but I'm not booking him again because his attitude sucks.
Yeah, yeah.
Not that I have any power over that, but my opinion does matter because Kevin's, you know, a bunch of times, like, you know, if somebody comes in, hey, Ryan, have you heard of this guy or girl? Yeah. How are they? They're not bad. Okay, cool, yeah, because we got them booked. Like, so they're good? Yeah, man, straight, yeah. Or, I'm not going to name any names, but there's been some people I'm like, oh, God, no, you don't want to book that guy. Oh, no, that's horrible. Don't do it, you know. And it was only always based off performance. It was never based off, like, if I didn't like the guy or whatever.
Yeah.
I don't have any heat with anything like that.
Yeah.
You know, so it was just always a thing of, like, hey, man, if you're trying to make the show really good, like, this guy's a nice guy, but... Don't know. Maybe do a run-in. That's about it.
Ooh,
you know, yeah.
Maybe.
Yeah, maybe.
Pull apart. They're part of the pull apart.
They pull something. A rope, I don't give a shit. A turnbuckle pad, whatever. Pull something.
Now, finally, my girlfriend says would like you to tell everyone how you came to owe her a meal.
Oh, whatever, chap. God, suck my ass. I hate you. It's true, though. I do owe them a meal. I know.
Wipe so go ahead. No, shit. No. Now you must reveal why it is that you owe us a meal.
Well, kids, a little inside story about Ryan Davidson. I don't gamble. Oh, she's sitting there. Jesus. All right.
She heard you. She heard you. She
now you want to come out and listen to the interview.
She heard about the meal.
Yeah.
This free meal
she's owed. They owed a free meal because I made a bet just talking, because if anybody knows Chop Sam, she is a diehard, insane, unrealistic fan of Dwayne The Rock Johnson. Like, I'm going to rape this man, he's going to rape me. We're gonna have babies and blah.
You gotta,
like,
tell the whole internet just, my secret.
Yeah, I'm gonna say the whole internet knows. It's just awesome. So she's obsessed with The Rock, and I was at the time of Rock, John Cena, once in a life.
What?
Once in a lifetime.
That's a drinking game. Just watch money, WrestleMania 20.
Make this run 6 years. I don't care. Fuck. Give me a new RV bus. Oh man, fuck it. Anyways, so there's that, and I'm like, I'm literally just kind of like, man. I don't care what anybody says, John Cena's the man.
Yeah, yeah.
He's the man. That is Superman incarnate. Like, that guy's awesome. And I'm sitting there going, Rock ain't gonna stay. That guy's gonna lose. And it was just like, Rock, like, okay, man, cool, whatever, because he's all, like, tight Under Armour shit, whatever. And then everything like that. Of course, she throws a fit. no, The Rock's gonna win. So what do I do? Since I don't gamble, I think I'll gamble, right? Why not? Thanks, John. You know, I'll even bet on wrestling.
Damn you, like, John.
John Cena's gonna win, man, because he's the shit. He's awesome. And then, of course, The Rock won, and my bet was that I would owe her and DeMarco a meal, whatever they liked. As long as it wasn't too crazy, I'm not taking you to Vic and Anthony's Steakhouse.
Oh,
I'll take you to Carrabba's.
Oh,
you know, nice. Something.
Brunch tomorrow?
Brunch? I'm not doing brunch. I got plans. But
oh, he's got plans.
I would love some brunch, but yeah, no. Yeah, I owe them a meal. Yeah, whatever. And I haven't done it since.
Proof that was like
3 WrestleManias ago.
Proof that someone who's not even in the business can outpredict you guys within the business.
Pretty much.
Both were like, there's no way. John's gonna win.
Just like, I mean,
John's gonna
you
win.
You don't understand, Chop. I've been watching wrestling my whole life.
We're in
the business.
Oh my God. She was like, nope.
Yeah,
nope.
I know. John Cena wins. She's like, give a fuck what you say, Rock's gonna win.
Oh,
and his dick
God.
Is huge.
Oh my God.
That's just like,
oh.
Thanks, Chad. Appreciate it. Yeah.
So we'll be the first to watch Hercules.
Yeah,
don't worry.
I know.
We'll
we're not going to be the first one to watch Hercules. I see the G.I. Joe poster in the workout room. Jesus. Fucking him in like a bicep, tricep pose. Almost like Conan epic, you know? Just, anyway.
So anything you want to plug before we wrap this up? Any, like, Twitter, Facebook? Are you active on Twitter?
I am active on Twitter.
You active Twitter?
I am. I've been a lot more active. I'm really big on Instagram right now.
Oh, okay.
Been on that. I've been trying to take a lot more photos and everything like that. So Instagram. Of course, there's Facebook. But for Facebook, obviously, is Ruthless Ryan Davidson.
Mm-hmm.
Twitter would be in all caps. The letter R, the letter D, Bear, B-E-A-R, 5-7, college football number.
Ah, okay.
Well, not in the photo. The photo, it's I'm wearing a different number, but that was, yeah, long story. Anyways, 5-7 for Twitter, and then it's the same thing for Instagram, but it's all lowercase.
Oh, okay.
So, you know, check me out. iPay-per-view, Summer of Mania, Summer Mania, Summer of Champions. Hubble Civic Center.
You know,
Bell Time 7:30.
Oh man,
DDP, man. Yeah.
Oh my God,
dude.
Did
man,
you start
I did
doing
yoga
yoga
this morning?
Oh
man.
My God,
oh.
Before the
fans. Let me meet this guy. I'm all fanboys. So like, bro, can you fucking the diamond cutter?
Diamond cutter.
You're like, get out of here, fag. Like, fucking do a warrior two and shut the fuck up. You know, some shit. Because you're diamond dozen. Get out of here, asshole. Yeah. But no, man, fucking DDP, like, it's crazy. It's going to be a great show. But yeah, to plug in all those things, all these Q&A things.
No, we're done. We're done.
I wish people would give me more podcasts.
Oh, I thought, weren't you going to do a podcast?
I am going to do a podcast.
Are you? Do you have, when do you know?
I am. I just have to buy the equipment, which is going to be like a couple $100.
Ah,
so
okay.
Nice. I mean, not like crazy nice, but like, you know, make sure I have a nice microphone, nice mixer, nice headphones.
Do it right.
So it's like, yeah, $200. And I want to do it to where it's just like,
kind of like this, but
wrestling. But like, tell it how it is, though. I don't, you know what? If people get offended or if they're like, you know, Ryan was really a dick on that, fuck you, this is how I really feel. And I'm not going to actively be an asshole, but if I'm going to say, like, you know, that match was god awful, it was god awful.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm not going to sit there and go, hey, this guy's awesome, but it's like, no, he's the drizzling shits. Like, I'm not going to sit there and bash him, but I'm going to be like, that's going to need some work.
Yeah,
you
yeah.
know, or like, and just talk about stuff that I'll call guys out on stuff. Not like guys like, oh, hey, you so-and-so, but like call, you know, you hear that mass rumor about guys when they say this or that. And it's mm-hmm. like, motherfucker, like you, don't be that guy.
Yeah.
Whatever. But I mean, controversial. Controversy creates.
Oh my God! I think we have that book. Oh, we do have that book. Oh man!
I'm back.
Oh God!
And I'm better than ever.
You're gonna get Eric Bischoff.
Oh, fucking stupidest intro.
And I hear Book will do your podcast once you get it up.
Yes, there. He will. And Stevie Ray. Will
yeah, do I would think you would get Stevie Ray.
I'll be honest with you. I'll get Charmel on there. I think Charmel would be a great podcast.
No, she's got a really interesting story.
Dance career, yeah. James Brown dancer, how she came up. She's got a degree in mathematics or business finance, something like that. Mm-hmm. I don't know. Or business or something. And then, I mean, she's had a crazy, you know, and she has crazy wrestling experiences, you know, and everything too. She'd be an awesome podcast. I don't even know why she doesn't have a podcast now. Jeez. You know, but, you know.
Well, thanks,
get all
buddy.
That stuff. Like, try to get some football players too, if I can.
Yeah, man. Guys from the Texans.
Yeah, maybe. Brandon Williams will come on my podcast, and I'll be like,
big wrestling fan.
I'll be like, say, man, where's JJ Watt's number at, bro? JJ, how are we talking about football? You ever watch wrestling? ROW, here's Flyer. Run away, you know. You know, fucking, that'd be awesome. Anyways, yeah, I'm going to try to get that started. But yeah, nah, man, it's all good. I'm not going anywhere. I'm just chilling.
Well, we're going to end it. We're going to end it now.
While we
just say bye.
I don't want to say bye. I thought you said you were done.
I'm done, but
it's still recording?
Well, it is, because
God dang it.
We don't have
whatever.